Hola? ¿Hay alguien ahí?
Hello? What happened here?
What do you have, something hidden?
C'est la aucun sens. Assistance!
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome, a very warm welcome to the ARRI panel on the Camerimage 2021. First of all, not on script, but it's such a pleasure to be back in person, seeing people. We've spent spent 1.5 years probably in front of a computer screen, so it's a pleasure to be here, and thank you very much for coming tonight. Today, we'll be talking about mixed reality. We might also talk about virtual production. And I have a colleague here lining up that will explain to you that this is actually exactly the same. So don't worry. Mixed reality has been in our mouths, ears, in the industry now for quite a few months already. It's been a hype. It's been the new thing, the new kid on the block. Today, we want to get some people in here and talk about mixed reality from a cinematographer's point of view to see actually what does it mean, how do you produce, how do you deal with such an instrument and kind of demystify this. We'll have Stephan Schenk here from ARRI Sales and Solutions, who is actually running the mixed reality team. We have DOP Rob Payton here, who has been spending probably the last months in the dark in the ARRI stage in London. And I'm very excited to have Nik Summerer here, who shot 1899, who just wrapped actually in the last weeks. And he's been 6 months in the mixed reality stage in Babelsberg. We've seen the teaser now of 1899. It doesn't show much, and I can promise you we'll also not see much else from this. Unfortunately, it's not been released, but I can promise you once it will be released, it looks amazing. And it's beautiful, and we'll be back. As soon as we have some footage, we'll be back and look at it together. My name is David Bermbach. I'm head of technology for the ARRI Rental Group. Relatively fresh, so we'll see. But I've been with Cinetechnik before, so I know my old colleagues very well. I've also been as a one ARRI team responsible for building the stage in Berlin with lots of colleagues and partners. And before we start in the discussion, I want to give you a quick overview of like, how does it work? What is this mixed reality? Mixed reality for us, it's the definition of the physical and the virtual world combined. And not combined in post or somewhere, but in camera. How do you do that? How do you do that on set? You have a physical world, and you have a 3D model. You have an Unreal Engine or a real-time engine where you have a model of the world that you can design yourself. This will be rendered out as an image, and this image through an LED processor will be displayed on a wall. LED screens, actually we have some here too, but much bigger in the background of our physical scene. All those things will then be combined in camera on the stage into one image. And I think that's the key of this whole thing. You create a final image already in camera, like it used to be in the 1950s, perhaps. In order for this to work, you can't just film it, otherwise it looks like the 1950s. What we need is to feed information from camera and lens back into the virtual scene, like focus, so that you can defocus the background. We also need to know where the camera is. So there's always a positioning system on the camera to tell the LEDs what actually to show and how the parallax will work. And while this is a basic setup, usually you will also have some physical lights in front. Also, those can be organized and can be actually controlled through the virtual world or the other way around. You can control the physical lights and you have a digital twin in the engine. And now, if that's not complicated enough, we have to have a sync infrastructure in there too. So we have to make sure that camera, LED wall, they're all working together to reduce the artifacts, to not have rolling shutter artifacts, LED artifacts. Yeah, so it's actually what you can see is there are not really new components here. The key of this is to use components that work well and build systems and solutions out of it so that you can actually use it in this way. And therefore, I want to get my colleague, Mr. Stephan Schenk, Managing Director Global Sales and Solutions, on the stage. Welcome, Stephan. Because Stephan will not only sell you the products, but he also makes sure that you build a nice solution for you out of it.
Thank you, David, for the nice introduction. Warm welcome also from my side. Very good to see you. Yeah, David explained it already. LED walls, that is not a new thing. It has been around in other applications and industries for quite a while. And at the latest, after Greg Fraser and Baz Idwin used it for shooting The Mandalorian, it also has reached the high-end cine-style production segment. And there was a lot of buzz going around after that, after The Mandalorian. It's been in everybody's, you know, magazine and so on. So where there is buzz, there are also buzzwords. You have heard now already mixed reality, virtual production. There is another one, extended reality. So you find that in particular if you go to China, everything is extended reality. This is all the same thing. So you don't have to look for what's the difference between mixed reality and virtual production and extended reality. They all describe the same thing, which is what David just explained. We at ARRI, we feel that if you shoot a real scene with real actors on one side, and you have a virtual world in the background, you mix realities, hence mixed realities. So I think it describes it pretty clearly, and this is why you will find from us this word. Yeah, thankfully, Greg Fraser and after Baz Idwin used our Alexa LF cameras for shooting The Mandalorian, and they did great. And of course, we were in touch with them, and we discussed, so what was good, what was bad, what was hindering you, what do we have to improve, what can we do as a manufacturer to support you on getting better and making better images, easier workflows, and so on. So out of that, we founded a team in ARRI, and David was fundamental in that, I can say, yeah, as really important part in it. And we not just discussed in a group, we built stages ourselves. So we first built a small stage in Munich, not a big surprise, actually close to Munich, together at the premises of ARRI Rental in Munich. And we had a little LED wall there, and we tested and looked into the thing. And actually that was also a test bed for what was then going to happen in the real thing, which was 1899. Which was a stage we built for Dark Bay, which is obviously the company that set up that stage at the premises of Studio Babelsberg for the production Dark Ways, which is the one that shot Dark and now 1899, or produced Dark and now 1899. So that these two went very well together in testing and then proving it, and we will hear about that later. We will then also hear about Uxbridge. So in our London facility, so also where our sales and rental facilities are in Uxbridge in London, we build a real stage ourselves. And we also, the colleagues of ARRI Rental are doing that, operate it. We will hear about that later on as well from Rob. And also in Burbank, in our ARRI office in Burbank in LA, we also have a demo and test stage. So We're not just talking, we know, we really know it firsthand what this is about. And so we learned a lot. And one thing we really learned, you know, above it all is it only works if everything, all the puzzle pieces fall together, if all the elements work together. And that is not just putting a camera and some lights in a big stage and put an LED wall and start shooting. It's far more. So it's about the whole setting up of the orchestration of all the elements in such a stage. And so we decided in ARRI, and that is was in the press a couple of weeks ago announced, and also we'll repeat that here. In addition to the products, so hardware and software from ARRI, we also add now services, design and engineering of mixed reality stages. And this offering we not only do in Berlin, we do that where all our subsidiaries are. So we do it in Asia. We have a team in Asia. We have a team in the Americas. And we have a team in Europe. Of course, the one in London, but also in Berlin. And the Berlin team actually has been acting in this since over 20 years already. They build broadcast stages, broadcast studios, particularly focused on the lighting side. So I have a lot of experience in this. And now we will open it up to support everybody who wants to create a stage or set up a stage, a studio, shooting mixed reality. So if you are about to enter in such a production, please feel free, contact us, and we will try to support you as good as we can to you know, make it really, to orchestrate the whole thing, to make it really work. And I don't want to leave the stage without giving out a big shout out to all the partners. So it's not just ARRI, there are a lot of partners involved. So the wall, of course, companies like ROI, there are tracking systems, company like Moses or Vicon or Trackman. There are many, many partners that we have to integrate, and they all supported this journey. And so we're really thankful for this cooperation. But this all would be nothing. All the technology would be nothing without you, without the cinematographers, without shooting. So, and that is why, of course, it's much better than me talking about it. It's better to have cinematographers talk about it. So I will give the stage now to our friends, and David, you take over, I guess.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stephan. Please have a seat. You've already seen it in the background, and now we get to meet the person who basically lives in there. welcome, Rob. Rob Payton, Director of Photography, director. Hello, Rob. Good
Hello.
To see you.
Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for allowing me to share my enthusiasm for this amazing bit of tech.
Excellent. So why are you here? I mean, how did it happen? How did you start this very early journey into mixed reality?
I think probably the catalyst was the beginning of coronavirus. I think that people started to think how the technology was there. Greg had been doing his work on Mandalorian. They were well into the second season of Mandalorian by then. But I think people started thinking about different ways of making productions work when we weren't able to travel, when we were having to work with reduced crew sizes. And so I think the coronavirus was a catalyst. It also meant that my production schedule was completely out the window. I was available. It was a bit of a perfect storm because our collaborators on this, Creative Technologies, who were traditionally doing live events, the live events industry completely dried up. So there was an awful lot of LED walls sitting around and quite a few DOPs and cameras that were available to play and test.
So basically the components were there and... Yeah, but then why ARRI? How did it happen now that we have this thing here in London right now?
We put up a test stage, really just to try and find the banana skins, which was a very primitive stage that that went up a year ago, 18 months ago now. And there was always the knowledge that there was going to be a full-time stage going there afterwards. Mm-hmm. I mean, the attraction of entering to this with ARRI was, I think, ARRI were also very, very early adopters. of the technology, and they saw from the outset that it was really critical that there was integration between traditional cameras, traditional camera technology, cinematography, art department. I mean, it is mixed reality. It is a combination of the two technologies. And it was clear from the initial conversations with the guys in London and the guys in Munich that they were very on board to embrace the technology and to be part of it.
Yeah. So what is there right now? I mean, how does your workspace look now? I mean, we see something, but
you see
as usually you don't see
there.
Much from the outside.
No, sure. The main components are an InVision wall, which is 30 meters by 5 meters high, so 6:1 aspect ratio on the main wall. That's an InVision wall. There's a motorized ceiling for providing top light. There's two side wild walls, which people have nicknamed siege weapons, which we bring into the set, and they'll help us create reflections, and they can appear to a limited degree in vision. And then there's a back wall. People get obsessed about pixel pitch, and you know, the finer the pixel pitch, the better the image. I think there's lots of other considerations there. You have to be thinking about color rendition. You also have to be thinking about viewing angle, and with that in, and obviously the brightness of the screens. With that in mind, there's actually three different products being used on the ARRI stage in Uxbridge, and each serving its own purpose. There's a ROI 2.3mm Ruby InVision wall, which we tested a number of products, and that one's worked well, and it works spectacularly well with the LF sensor. Then on the ceiling, we've recently changed the ceiling out because we weren't happy with the color rendition we were getting off the LED for the ceiling. And I think when Nick comes on, he'll be talking about that to a degree of similar issues that he had with color rendition on the shoot in Babelsberg. And so we've swapped that out for Black Onyx, which is a 4.6mm product from memory. And then the two siege weapons and the back wall consist of a 5mm product, which is a lot brighter. It's more of a display product. But you know, those elements never appear in vision. They're basically there to provide lighting and also
and
to
reflections.
Reflections and to give context to the artists.
Yeah. So this is the setup, and I understand. I mean, this is quickly evolving. There's always something new coming out. I mean, component-wise, it's always difficult. Now, what are you doing in there, and what kind of banana skins did you already slip on, or did get out of the way? How does it feel?
Well, the studio is serving three purposes. I mean, it is a working production studio, which productions come in and can rent and hire. It's also a critical component of it is for R&D and for research, and it's also used to a degree as an event space as well. So in terms of the day-to-day utilization, I mean, at the moment there's a pop promo about to go in there. We've had long-form TV drama, and we've had some feature films in there. Mm-hmm. And ARRI held a couple of amazing events in the absence of a lot of the trade shows that haven't been happening. They put on a couple of amazing events over the last few months.
Okay. And the banana skins? What's the worst? Just one.
I think everybody's obsessing about moiré, about multi-camera use on the stage, about color rendition. We've encountered those challenges along the way. There's now a very, very good color calibration process in place between the ARRI cameras and the back wall, so there's no nasty surprises there. There's some great lens integration that's going on, FIS data going directly into Unreal Engine in real time. So yeah, I mean, we're aware that there are challenges. The evolution of the technology is very, very fast. I mean, the studio's had three upgrades in the last 12 months, you know, and I've probably shot 50, 60 days in there over the last 12 months, and
for various projects, I think.
For various projects,
short
yeah.
projects,
mm-hmm.
anything. Yeah. And it's still the time where you get to know these things, I guess. But one thing, somebody comes in for the first time, the one thing you recommend?
Test. I mean, you're moving your schedule very much. You know, you're basically pulling your post-production and bringing it into your pre-production. So a lot of that work that would have been done by your VFX house in post is being done in pre. But what that is, what we're finding with all the productions who come into the stage, is it then becomes a very, very collaborative process. You're not leaving everything till the tail end. You know, you're integrating with your art department, with your VFX house, right in very early stages of production.
Yep.
The one thing would be test. But you know, the fascinating thing about the space is, having shot in it, you know, on a number of occasions, it's a piece of technology that actually allows you to have control and creativity at the same time. And traditionally on a film set, those aren't great bed partners. Yep. You know, you want to increase control, but that's at the expense of creativity. But because you've got absolute control over the lighting, you've got absolute control over time of day, you can whiz around the world in, you know, we had one shoot in there where I think we did 7 locations, 17 setups in a day, which, you know, producers like that.
Thank you very much. Well, I'm pretty sure there will be lots of discussions later on. We'll have a Q&A with everybody here after the next round. And thank you very much, Rob. So 1 year ago, we were sitting down with Philip, with Bo, with Nick in Berlin. And there was a discussion on the table to build a big stage, a big LED stage in Berlin. It was an impressive project. It was a bit of a scary project, honestly, because, I mean, who had experience with this? But it was clearly from the beginning, this is the project we want to participate in, because it's a project that was driven by creative people. It was driven by a project, by a show that needed such a stage such an instrument to realize their vision, their amazing vision. And so I want to welcome now Nik Summerer, who actually played this instrument in the last months. Thank you very much, Nik, for coming.
Thank you, hello.
Yeah, welcome. Now, your journey even started before we came on board, I think 1.5 years ago. And then there was the Shepperton tests and lots of stuff happening. And now you just came out of 6 months in this stage. Can you tell us a little bit how was that journey?
Yeah, that was certainly a very interesting journey and a very steep learning curve within the last 1.5 years. I came to this project on a very different way. So I'm not a very technical interested camera or cinematographer. I do a lot of things what feels right. I'm familiar with the technology, of course, but this kind of thing was very new to me. I knew that there are LED walls. People have worked with it on numerous projects, but a volume, I haven't even heard about it when I was approached for this project. So Bo told me, yeah, we're shooting this thing. I heard about it. We've been still working on Dark Season 3. He talked about it all happening on a ship around 1899. I thought it's very exciting. We're all going on a ship. And then he said to me, just before this whole project was announced, it's happening in a virtual stage in a volume. And if you don't know what this is, he said, watch the making of The Mandalorian. So I did, and I just saw these things and thought, well, that's probably not going to happen. You know, there's just Hollywood stuff here, and we're doing this in Germany. And also, Dark was very successful. I don't think that this is just really...
It's so big, it's just so new
and everything. But very soon after, there were talks with all kind of people. ARRI was involved in this thing to make it happen, to ask the questions, how can this be get out of the ground? Nowhere was really a proper stage. There were little stages, the one that you mentioned before, Stephan, in outside of Munich. We visited this one, but you can't really see much in it. There's a camera in it. There's a forest scene was on the walls. You have a camera in there. You can put a person in front of it, so you see that this person looks like as if the person would stand in a forest, but it actually doesn't look like much. It just doesn't really match one another. The person is green, but you can have this when you go in a green screen stage as well. So that's not really the.
That's a new.
No, yeah, it's just not. It's just not good enough. So all that I could do was at the time then to go and look back at this Mandalorian making off again and again, watch the series and see what have they been doing, what is interesting out of the show for us, and what needs to maybe change, or what is an alternative for us, or how can we make this whole volume technology to work for our show. So if you're not familiar with Mandalorian, I just quickly tell this, it's a story about a person out of the Star Wars family. It's a bounty hunter who has a very shiny armor and a helmet, a round helmet that reflects everything. So that's what they've been shooting in the volume. It makes completely sense that you have all around actually something that can reflect into this reflective.
It's been about also not just what you see, but also what is reflected. That what on Mandalorian was one of the key things. Now you have a completely different. I mean, for you it was a completely different settings. It's much more realistic. Also, I would expect very much darker and more gritty environment. How did that play then with the volume? I mean, how?
So that's right. Our show is taking place on a ship. It's actually an immigrant ship around 1899. The ship is coming from Europe with all kind of people from different European countries going to the States, all having a very good reason to go to the States and leave their old life behind them. And so at the time, well, COVID hit, so it was a good reason to go into a volume, as well as we've wanted to create something that was just not easy to go and to do on a ship. So an old ship like this doesn't exist. You can't work on it. And the most of the big environment in the ship, like let's say a boiler room or a big, big, massive dining room, doesn't exist as well either. So the reason to go into the volume was to also to avoid a green screen studio, because also, being on an ancient ship has done before in green screen, but whoever been in a green screen studio for longer than, well,
a few days, no,
a few hours, knows that this is very, very painful, and this is not enjoyable for nobody. You know, the actors have to imagine that there is outside whatever is outside, and everybody else as well. Also, you also get very aggressive with this, especially green, you know?
It might be helpful in some times.
It's not a happy place.
No.
When it was clear we're going into the stage, the stage is slowly building up, but there was still, before this, were the questions of like, how do you set up this stage? What do we need? It's also a money issue at one point. It's like as if you renovate your own bathroom at home, and then at one point you say, okay, so is it these kind of like, is it this sink or maybe the cheaper one? And so it was also the question of what kind of like ceiling are we having, a big ceiling, massive ceiling. All we relate to and always we came back to was everything that was a Mandalorian, because nobody knew anything different really. So he was thinking, okay, so we need this ceiling. But we've been shooting. So this was in March when I first heard about it. Then I tried to learn as much as I could. I had the opportunity to talk to Baz Iduin, the other camera or cinematographer from Mandalorian, and he kind of like filled the gaps that I had with just watching the Mandalorian and the making of. And he told me a couple more things, but overall there were more questions than actually answers. So finally, in August in last year, we went to London and to have a little bit of a LED, 12-meter LED wall behind us, a tiny ceiling above us, and two of these side walls that you can move around. And we've been there a week in this studio and just tested it. And it was at times exciting, because we created something where you have a reflection and you see a person that's walking around, and it's all this dim light, some sunset situation, all looks great. It was frustrating at other times because you wanted to create something. We had a desert scene that didn't work at all with like hard light, not at all. It looked really mm-hmm. awful for whatever we tried. And then some things that were okay. Yeah. But we learned a lot out of this, and one of the things was like how, for example, can we what how are we working with set design in the foreground and the background? What is to look for it? We also learned that skin tones is a big problem, and so for me was, and we've been very lucky in this regard because we kind of like created this stage, this volume for our purposes, and I said, look. Instead of having this very expensive ceiling, what about if we just introduce, and you see it up here, it's a little bit hidden behind the duvetine, but there's all sky panel boxes, top light from above, because we don't really have the problem with reflections, whatever the angles probably are from our camera, all we see is actually the wall on the other side. Let's just raise the wall another meter. That's actually more beneficial than having the ceiling for in our case.
Yeah.
And it was a very good decision. I think everybody was happy with it, and we've been much more flexible. Also, being on a ship, you know, we can work with, there's a lightning coming, or different scenarios of, I don't know, cloud movement or whatever. Color temperature changes can all be done, you know, on the stage, and you don't have to rely on the wall or, you know, deal with color shifts. Yeah. And on the skin tones, because of the ceiling.
Well, one of the problem then was really like the walls, the color quality of those walls is really not something that is pleasing to skin tones, and you have lots of different skin tones in this
yes.
show. So, how did you light those? I mean, how does the lighting work? What is coming in digital? How then do you light the scene when you're on stage?
So, yeah, I wasn't happy with the skin tones at all. And as you mentioned, we have our lead cast has very pale porcelain-like skin with red hair. But we also have a black person in it. We have people with a lot of facial hair, like our captain, who's like dark hair. And it's just all kind of skins that are in there. But the problem certainly is that the skin tones that you kind of like get from these walls, they are actually only working with three LEDs, yeah. red, green, and blue. It's just not the best. It's just not good, you know? And so it's a little bit of a workaround around the whole yeah. thing. You can do and get the better results in grading, and obviously you have a camera lab that helps you with it, but skin tones is still the main the problem. King. So mixing it with another light source, whatever it is, for example, sky panels or an LED light that has good skin tone rendering. I heard from a cinematographer in LA who is working on a show, and he's mixing in actually tungsten light purposely to get these missing spikes yeah. into mm-hmm. it, you know, with just having another light source in it and getting rid of it. So there are different ways of getting around it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So in this, I mean, you've used the stage, as I have seen and heard, I mean, in ways that hasn't been done before. I mean, you had water, you really had lots of water in this, and you had lots of atmospherics. Did that work? I mean, how does it look?
Yeah, it worked very well actually to have atmosphere in it. Mm-hmm. The director for this show, he's always goes a little bit crazy on atmosphere. So he's sometimes he's putting a little bit too much, or wants to see a little bit too much of atmosphere in the thing in the frames to my liking. But it's actually working very well. If something is moving in the foreground, all kind of like distractions in the foreground, and of course actors are distracting to look at the background. Yeah. That's all good. But everything helps a little bit to make it actually real and live. So what our intention was to have these sets as close to reality as possible. So we wouldn't want to go into the show and have it like a little bit comic-like,
mm-hmm.
yeah, like looking like a game engine, also all our backgrounds, but one was actually based on a game engine.
On a 3D model and not plates.
Right. We had one scenario that was a landscape that was actually a real landscape that was with photogrammetry, that's mm-hmm. like a scan of a landscape put together and where you can move around in it, but everything else was actually
digitally created
out of a game engine, out of Unreal, basically.
So how do we imagine that? I mean, if you have the scene in Unreal, somebody programs that, but that's only the start, I guess. And how do you end up with filming that? I mean, who is involved and how do you communicate?
You have beforehand, like on a real normal shoot, you have a scouting, mm-hmm. but in a 3D environment. So in our case, with the ship again, and the majority of the show takes place on this ship, there was the question like, which sets can we actually put into the volume, and mm-hmm. which sets make more sense to build on a proper stage?
As you made, like, if it was a 50-50 real stage.
It was not set build exactly 50. It was 50 days at the end and 70 days in studio, mm-hmm. in a normal classical studio, yeah. but 50 days in the volume. Yeah. So the ship was created beforehand based on a ship, like actually I don't know if you say this, a sister ship of the Titanic, so out of the same fleet, but a smaller boat actually. Mm-hmm. And they alternated it according to the story. Whatever we needed was added to it. And so we had a proper 3D model of the ship.
You had the location, basically. So the
as a location, right. Yeah. And then based on the script that we had, we kind of like walked with 3D goggles, you know, with this VR mm-hmm. goggles. We walked through the ship and flying around there, very funny process in the beginning, and then very sickening after a while. but you just walk through the ship and then just like get yourself familiar with it. Later on, you go around and just determine camera angles. Where would you be? What is it that you're probably doing? Going back to an outside location on the deck, where is the majority of the action taking place? So you know in the story you need a deck, and I don't know what's happening, people just standing at the railing looking out, you know, or they arguing or whatever, somebody's falling off a ship, or somebody's climbing a ship, or, you know, Titanic, somebody's holding someone over the railing or whatever. All these things are possible. So you go there, you just go with a virtual camera and see where is this actually happening. Is it more in the body of the in the middle of the deck, or is it more on the sides of the deck? And this determines a little bit, and this is all very, very important, because it determines of what you see in the background on the wall. Mm-hmm. And whenever you decide for an angle, this tells the VR the VFX team what they need to look for and what needs to be built in the engine.
In real. Or in real and in the engine, basically, you have to decide.
Yeah. Obviously, it all exists, but it needs to be, because somewhere is the stage. You know, this is actually, there's no VR world. You just see the real proper stage floor, mm-hmm. and then you decide, well, maybe what is the alternative that you can do? Well, you raise the whole deck up a bit, and so that you don't see so much the stage floor itself. But when you raise it up, you kind of like limit yourself, because the stage is just endless, and
you can't see above the stage. Yeah.
So there's just always a little bit of a compromise that you're going. Mm-hmm. But these are kind of like the things that you learned in the beginning, and there's a sweet spot in the volume that is about 4.5 to 5 meters away from the wall. So you try to put wherever the most action is taking place around this much away from the wall, mm-hmm. and then this determines you. So you have in the 3D world, you see the ship, and you see actually like with a cookie cutter, you see where you place your volume. You can actually they built a model so you can see exactly where this would be. Then you realize, okay, somebody has to go and walk onto this deck. But this is too big for the stage that we're having, so the whole thing has to shrink a little bit. And you suddenly, as a cinematographer, are involved in all these things, you know, just to think these things through, to make a remark, to to question these things and, yeah. And bring them forward. This is all very, very new and has nothing to do with the life before before a volume.
But this, I mean, those are all like so many decisions that you actually all have to do before you actually shoot, and then it's in. I mean, is this a, do you see this as a positive thing because then you own it, or is it more risky because you have to make decisions that are not changeable, or can they be changed?
I don't know. It's just you're involved in all these decisions, and that's actually a good thing. I think you know what's going on early on, because of everything was new here. We've been early on discussing with the production designer, myself, the director, of how we are able to overcome the transition that you see at the end a little bit between the wall and actually the floor. The same is true for the ceiling, how you overcome them, and you're coming up with ideas, and you be on the process in the beginning to be involved, and you know there are tricks to do it, and you just work on them together. So that is actually a good process, and it's all new. So it's again, we heard this before, so going into a volume, I don't believe that you can go in a volume. Also, this might be a little bit the feeling after watching the making of Mandalorian, or what some people have heard, some directors or some producers might believe. You go in there and you flip a switch and then you start shooting. You definitely have to have your ducks in a row. You have to have yourself familiarized with this place. If nothing else, then just be familiar with it. Mm-hmm. You have new people that you have to talk to. You know, the whole brain bar, that's basically the computer wizards that's sitting somewhere on the side of the stage. They are responsible for everything that is on the wall. And you communicate with them when you want to have the wall brighter, or you want to change in color temperature, or you want to, there's a, you know, a 3D person somewhere that is sticking out of your main actor's head, so you want to get this extra out of
the
way.
Just move it.
You do it with an extra, you say to the assistant director, get it out of the way, this person. Here, you can't just actually get rid of this person altogether, but it's something that I've been working so hard to get, you know, just exactly to avoid this, until I remembered actually I can do this. I can shift elements around, and then you do it for the next time. Yeah. I know, but about these 10 days before, when I was just dealing with these kind of things, as a column or whatever, you don't think about it. So these things, for example.
So it's a new creative freedom that you actually then are able to use right on set to move things around that you would never do and walk
right
around in a normal environment.
So this gives you also a lot of the actual creativity or the control of the final image back into the cinematographer's hand more. Because usually, again, you work in an environment, it's just like a green screen behind it. Very often, I was in productions where you have no idea actually how the background really looks like. What kind of sky is there? What kind of landscape is there? Well, the landscape kind of, you know, but you don't know these kind of things. And some VFX person who's not contacting you is just working on it and deciding, well, a tree might be here, the foreground person is here, and there's another church, I don't know. And this is about this. Yeah. It should be like this. But you would say, well, in order, that's a quote from Greg Fraser. The difference between a great shot or a good shot and a great shot can be with the camera a couple of inches to the left or to the right. And I also really believe into framing. I think it's one of the most important things in cinematography, to have and create a relationship between two people. With the framing, or a relationship between a person and an environment. Mm-hmm. But if just somebody else has a different feeling for how this should be right, then it's out of my hands, and I just can deal with it at the grading later and say, well, come on, but then it's too late.
So
and
you take back
I
control.
I can say exactly where I want to have the church in relation to the person, in relation to the tree, and make sense for my story.
Yeah. And that turned out very well, and we talked before, and it's, you said that you expect like up to 70% of the shots that you produced in the volume actually will end up exactly like that, and it's not no retouching.
This is the number that the producers are aiming for or hoping for. I don't know if this is working out this way. I can't say that we just wrapped the production, so I don't have a feeling for it. But I know that a lot of things actually worked very, very well in camera. Mm-hmm. To our surprise, they worked so well. One big set that I was scared a long time was actually this, what you see in the background here. That's a dining room. A dining room that is only existing out of four columns and about 16 or 17 tables and a hardwood floor that they put in the studio or in the volume. But then you see that it wasn't ready when we started production, so you just see kind of like things on a screen, on your computer screen, about the dining room, and it kind of looks okay, but you have no feeling about it, whether it really is okay, if it's matching mm-hmm. what they have in the foreground or the background. It's just a very scary thing, I think. And then you walk in the first time and you think, oh, and that's another scary thing. You can't really judge anything once you're walking in the volume. You can't judge anything by eye. So mm-hmm. all colors that you're seeing in the foreground or the background or on a person, it doesn't mean anything unless you see it through the camera and see it on a calibrated monitor. So it needs to go through your LUT, through all the processing, whatever it is, and arrive at your monitor. And this is where you're lighting from, mm-hmm. 100%. And this is why you can judge a picture and can judge whether the foreground and the background are working together. Yeah. So the biggest thing, we talked about it before, for lighting, actually pre-lighting one of these contents is to match the foreground and the background, mm-hmm. to bring them together, to marry them, that they actually work seamlessly.
And you do that by on the monitor. I mean, you use traditional lighting methods for the physical world, and
yes. So you hope that the wall is giving you as much light as possible mm-hmm. as it could, and then you go just very traditional. You just bring in your bounce or your mm-hmm. direct light or whatever you're working with, and just light whatever scene there is in the foreground. To your taste, the way you're working. Yeah.
And you enhance also the light coming from the background. You enhance with physical lights to make it more realistic and match. Like we talked about the silver linings and things. Yeah.
So there's a lot of benefits in the volume and everything, but there's also a couple of things, banana peels, let's call them, for me as a cinematographer, that are limiting and that you have to find workarounds. And one of them is the color, we talked about it, but the other thing is that the wall doesn't have enough
oomph.
You know, there is oomph missing in this wall. So you don't have the contrast level that you actually need. So this is also a reason why harsh sunlight is just working not as well, because it works in the foreground, but it doesn't. You don't see the same effect on the background. The shadows can't be as dark. It's just not working properly.
Yeah. So also darkness. I mean, extreme conditions like light and also darkness is a problem. You can't.
Yeah, darkness is also a problem because you can't go darker than the wall itself. It's just like off is off.
Yeah.
You
know, but it's a good example here. It's not dark.
A shiny gray. It's also when you have the volume, the shape that it is, the ends of the of this half circle, mm-hmm. or however big it is, are just actually shining onto the wall itself. So that kind of like lifts the level again of complete darkness. So you have to work around this as well, just with contrast that you're working with, or mm-hmm. just, you know, deal with it as it is.
You lift
us, or lift. Mm-hmm. For us, it was again, because the show was just starting in it. We've been lucky on one hand, but it also was chosen by us. The majority of these the environments are taking place in overcast, rain, all kind of things. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
So it's like flat lighting.
It's like a flat lighting, and then the wall and the foreground and the background is just not as contrast difference that you have to recreate in either of it. But While you talk about the silver lining, so we had the imagine the scenario: you'll be on the deck of the ship again. In the background, far, far on the horizon, there is a silver lining. You know, the sun just comes out after a rainy day, and you see this in the picture, but you don't see anything happening on the skin really, or just very, very little. And it should be actually more, even if it's just not the strongest light there, because you don't see the sun through, but you see the silver lining, and you would have this in reality. So you're trying to put a light there somewhere out of the frame, but then you have this, again, working with two cameras. One camera has this frostrum, so this tracking in
the high-quality render background.
Right. Mm-hmm. The other one is stealing it. Mm-hmm. So, but you just like limited your space where you can put a light, actually. Mm-hmm. In Mandalorian, they you know, just took some tiles out of the screens and been lighting through it. Yeah. We couldn't do this in our stage, just the way the stage was built. So fortunately, we had a catwalk above the above our wall, where I can light from the top of it and just create it, at least come out of the same direction and create something, you know, some harder contrast on the skin that it was actually giving it away, or giving it not so away, so just like kind of like augmenting or
getting realism back in, match foreground, what you see in what the background produces, that how it interacts with the physical. So, this was something that, as I said, and you actually achieved a realism, not just on camera, but also to a point where people got seasick on the boat. So there is something actually, like, you go come into the mood easier than on any other stage.
You be in there and you realize sometimes just some things are just not working right. Yeah. So for example, the deck was one of the first sets, and in our test phase beforehand, when we looked at the content, you just the ship, the water, and the sky just been all mounted together, and they just been moving together. But it didn't work. It's just not. It's just not
how
right.
Reality is.
But the funny thing is, also you exactly know how it is on a ship. You've been there, but you can't really put the finger on it. What is wrong here? And then just slowly you realize somebody makes a comment, and then you're just like starting doing this. So once they started unlocking the ship on one hand, the waves on the other, the sky on the third, then it suddenly feels alive. But this was a process, because at one point the software wasn't capable of. They had a turnaround, then there was a new update coming, then some things were suddenly possible. But yes, it leads to a point where actually some of the film crew been just seasick or felt somehow dizzy because of the ship was moving up and down. Yeah, but this is, and then coming back to what is the benefit of all this, just imagine as an actor being on a stage like this, you know, that looks like actually a ship, and having this movement of waves and everything. You have wind coming from the VFX team, there's a little bit of atmosphere coming through it, and you suddenly, you know,
you
feel on a ship. Yeah. It's just so much easier to imagine, and for everybody else as well. You know, for me to find a right angle, if you're more in this atmosphere, it's just a different way of working.
So you would do it again?
I would do it again, yeah. And again, it's not, the alternative is not to go on a ship. The alternative is to be in a green screen studio. And we've been there. You don't want to be there.
Absolutely. Well, thank you. Thank you very, very much, Nick. I mean, it's been a hell of a journey, and we're all looking forward to see the results soon. I guess beginning of next year, we might see a trailer. And please watch the show afterwards. It's really good. Thank you very much. Questions? I'm pretty sure there might be something in this. And I don't see much, so I'll... yes, sir, in the back here. Yeah. I'll just go out of the light because I don't see anybody here.
Thank you for sharing all the information. There's one question I'm wondering, because you were talking about it, is what were the things that did surprise you while shooting? And there's a second question towards ARRI. I'm pretty sure there's a lot of like eager DOPs here learning the same things that you learned already. Is there something that you could offer that we could come test it out, try it by ourselves, because I think it's great to hear it, but to experience it, to see it, would be so beneficial for all of us to learn. Thank you.
I know, absolutely. I feel I'm really, really sorry that I can't show anything. It's actually, you know, maybe next year when this is coming out, I can sit here again and we continue this, and I can show you on a good example, you know, on what we did. So it would be all in theory. I think it was, as I said before, it was frustrating in the beginning for me because I couldn't get the levels right and it didn't look naturalistic. But the more you're familiar with the whole thing and the more you work in it, and that's why what I would suggest, whenever you have the possibility, go in there, but don't be just excited about that you get a reflection on a table in a glass or in a bottle or whatever, but just like trying to have a person sitting in there, trying to have as much as a set possible in there to start matching foreground with background and make this happen. That's just basically the only thing that I can give you at this stage. Spend as much time in there as you can.
And what can ARRI do? Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe I can also add. So this is exactly why we built this test and demo stages in London, in the US, and also we are working on a bigger one in Munich. So I can only encourage you just to pop by and see. There is, you know, there are obviously a lot of these stages around the world, but with the help of these gentlemen here, I think we really learned a lot, and just come by and schedule a meeting and then find out what, you know, what is in for you and not. So this is really the offer I can make.
I mean, Nick's quite right. I mean, it is this, the learning curve is incredibly steep, and each day it's trial and error. And you know, one of the things that I've learned through working on the stage, I play with some on-camera filtration to help blend foreground and background. I also find that I don't think I've done a shot where there hasn't been some camera movement, some degree of camera movement, again, helps blend foreground and background, lens selection, but you've just got to get onto a volume and play and find out what doesn't work to enable you to find out what does work.
Thank you. Yes, here in blue jacket.
Ganz rechts, yeah. Schon ein.
Oh, oops. It's more, you're better with this, huh?
You hear me? Yeah, it's more about the post-production process and working with post-production company. Did you notice some very big difference with working with post-production companies, since they need to do real-time rendering instead of whatever it takes time of rendering? And does it bring some limitation in the what you can ask for them, maybe like in terms of maybe smoke simulation, particle simulation, and how do they change the way to work in this new situation?
Yes, I don't know. I guess you had much more work done before the shoot, so it's other limit. How did the work with the post?
Yeah, I'm probably the wrong person to ask this. In general, I know that I guess every post house has their different secrets and their different soups de jour that they are bringing in. And I think every post house is very good at one thing and at other things maybe just no only normal good. And I think it's just to find the right partners. I guess it's the same like how you get together your crew. Is also to find the right partner in the VFX team, in the VFX supervisors and the ones who create in the content. Do you like what they're doing? Is this what, you know, does it speak to you in a way? And then you go with them and just go with the ones that understood you the best.
I think you've got to rethink that whole post versus pre-production versus production. You know, that's all very, very mixed up now. And a lot of stuff's coming into pre. There's also, are you actually going for final pixel? I mean, we sit there as cinematographers and we don't want anybody to change our image afterwards, and we would, you know, and that's what Nick is saying, what's great about working on a volume. But there's quite a lot of productions that aren't going to final pixel on the LED wall. There will be elements added later. particles, smoke, things like this. So, you know, it depends really on whether... I mean, there's one production happening at the moment, and I know they're shooting on an LED volume, but they have the luxury of the budget that some of the shots they're rotoscoping, and the only reason they're using an LED volume is to give the actors something to interact with, but they're still planning to do a lot of post-work.
Yeah. Perhaps it's really the thing, there are some parts of the VFX pipeline that are just moved to the left, in front of the production instead of later, which means it's time constrained more. But there are also some things that a traditional post house might not have experienced, like Unreal Engine, like real-time rendering, making sure that the frames per second are there. This is something that also post-production house sometimes just start getting experience. And I think also our partner in the frame store, they've had a big learning curve. Like being on set, same as, like it's a very different world.
No, absolutely. It's also the communication has to be changed or learned, not changed. Yeah, it has to be changed and also been learned by the VFX team. Yeah. They suddenly, you know, have to say, okay, so if you make this change, how long does it take? And when they say 5 minutes, it needs to, you know, be 5 minutes. Yeah. It can be then 7, but it can't be 15. You know, it's just like this. They have to learn these things.
Yeah.
And we have to, in the beginning, accept that this, you know, is a little bit of a change.
Yeah.
We give time to, so this is actually happening. But there will be new professions coming up and new people that you communicate with. Also, in terms of lighting and VFX world, it will be an in between, you know, where you maybe as a gaffer you are able to move around certain things, certain elements. We haven't done this in our show, but I know that they do it at Mandalorian or done it in Mandalorian. Is it good or bad, or is it that, you know, that the gaffer has now this control? This is, I think, the dependence on the dynamic of the set. But it's all possible, you know, that you have the opportunities to do this, and that's so it's more tools in your toolbox. Yeah. Just get familiar with them.
Thank you very much. Here on the... Well, first we had this one here.
A bit of a technical... You on?
Yes, you're on.
Okay. a bit of a technical question. How do you deal with Moiré and making sure that the pixels are not visible on the wall?
Moiré wasn't a big deal for us. Is has to do with how we, you know, we had lenses that were with anamorphic lenses that kind of like the fall off was nice, and they weren't the sharpest lenses, so that helped certainly to kind of like smear it out a little bit, if you want to say so.
There's very few occasions when the back wall is sharp focus, you know, so it's not an issue. There you will find moiré if you go through a focus range of a lens on an LED wall, you will find a point where it will moiré. So it's about learning where that point is. The larger the sensor on the camera, the less issues that you've got with moiré. But the, you know, and the stage in London, I won't work closer than 2.5 meters to the back wall. And Nick was saying there was a sweet spot.
So we've been working on around about 4.5 meters, and trying to. trying to be not closer to it. And once you're really closer to it, or once you want to have a foreground person, you know, out of focus, looking at something in the back, you know that this is a replacement. It's just a fact. So you just, so then it's not such a big issue, actually.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, very high above here. Yes, you with a blue mask. In the middle.
Hi. How do you deal with backgrounds that have a lot of lighting change in terms of colors and intensity? There's any software that you can match with the sky panels or the orbiter to match the difference in the shifts of colors?
What we've done at Uxbridge, I mean, what you don't get from an LED source, as Nick was saying, you don't get a hard light. You can get a harsh light from it, but you don't get a hard light. So at Uxbridge now, we've got a ring of orbiters, of 50 orbiters, which I think one of the earlier images it was visible on, that are mapped into Unreal. So as the lighting background changes, those hard light change in unison with it. And so, yeah, pixel mapping is an exciting piece of technology, and also pixel mapping into sky panels, so that if you have got some, you know, if you're using foreground beauty lighting, that again is interacting in the same way as the LED wall is. So yeah, that compatibility is really important.
And the other question is, if it's in the ARRI future to make LED screens with a big arrays of color shifts in.
So Stephan.
Well, I don't see that. Yeah. This is not. I mean, LED lighting obviously is our topic, but LED walls, I don't know. I mean, there are so many manufacturers of these panels, and they're doing this, like I said in the beginning, this is not new, so they're doing that since quite a while. But what is also true is that everything we see today, so all the walls that have been used were not made for cinema. They were not made for cine-style productions. So since all the buzz going on, I'm pretty sure that it is already worked on good panels, I mean good in terms of cine-style, better for cine-style productions, and I think we haven't seen it yet what the capabilities of this wall will be, because that is standard stuff these gentlemen have used here. Once that comes into place, and if you see the stunning images that Nick shot, I'm pretty sure this technology, this way of shooting is here to stay. It's not a fad, it's not just a hype and then it goes away, because it's just starting and everybody is, you know, you hear the, what was it, banana shields?
Banana
here,
skins, yeah.
So we talked a lot about these, but I think they could also talk a lot about the advantages, and like Nick said, he would do it again, and I think with the event of new LED walls, better LED walls, I think that will even go further. Yeah. But to answer there's no strategy on our roadmap to do light LED walls.
It's a very exciting space to be in. I mean, that's one thing that's to be said. It's a very creative environment. What's interesting is if people come in to test for a day, they're quite nervous. They may be been told by their VFX house, you can't do this, you can't pan the camera fast, you can't point the camera up, you can't do X, Y, Z, and they come in very structured. And like any good director or good director of photography, give them 48 hours in there. By day two and day three, they're playing with it. They're breaking it. They're finding that they can do things that they couldn't otherwise do. So it's just about spending time in the volume. You know, it is a very flexible and creative environment to work in.
In the very back. Hi.
Hi there. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
So I'm just curious. You're talking about a minimum distance to the panels, 2.5 meters, a sweet spot of maybe 4 meters. But what would you consider would be a sort of minimum volume that you could have as a practical space to work with a small scene? You know, for someone trying to put this together somewhere.
I mean, that's really. I mean, you already got the ingredients for this equation. It's on this type of sensor that we have in those environments. We found out that you might need really up to 5 meters of death zone between where the focus is and the wall is to be flexible with lenses. And then it dictates kind of a 10-meter volume. You just have a person in the middle and he can't move. So you really extend it. I mean, we have in Berlin, it's about 20 to 25 meter diameter, because it's like an X shape.
I think it's about 23.
Yeah.
We have a turntable in there, so there's 21. So and yes. On the sides, there's about a meter on each side.
And in London, what's the diameter?
It's 30 meters with the curve, it's 19.
Yeah,
it's basically 19
so
across.
So if you go smaller, it still makes sense, and we have tested much smaller environments. But then it's not a complete volume. Then it makes sense just to have perhaps a 90-degree wall and still keep the distance and play. And you're just more limited. The thing is, even if you're limited and you shoot over the borders of the wall, it's usually not that big of a problem, because you actually have the 3D rendering, you have actually the content. It's living in the Unreal Engine anyways. That's what we talked before. Extending it in post is not as difficult. I mean, it's difficult if you have to rotoscope a lot, but in generally, you better keep the distance, and the part that you shoot on the wall looks good, and then you better replace everything around it.
Sure, thank you very much. So maybe like 25 meters by 25 meters could be a workable space, even with a 90-degree wall.
For like a roundish thing, yeah, like a 360
or 270. Within a studio, say a conventional studio, 25 or 20 meters by 20 meters, you could put a small practical volume within that you could build something or install something in that.
Yes, but if I was, I mean, you need a lot of extra space, I would say.
So I would say one of the limitations, again, for our project that we had was certainly that this is not a big space. So the staging that you have to have in there must also meet kind of like the way the director or the director and the cinematographer wants to tell the story. So in our case, Bo is more, you know, when people are talking or so, this is more like a more quiet in a lot of scenes. They're just standing at a place and, you know, is this thing. It's not a lot like walk and talk. But if you're a director who's like to do this all the time or the camera is flying around the whole time, then it's just a limit there that you can just fulfill.
Sure. Sorry, very final question. Do you treat depth of field in the same way you would in a real environment? Or do you sort of envision it the same as you would in a green screen shoot? Which would you sort of apply in terms of your technique?
From depth of field?
How do you deal with depth of field? I mean, are you taking care of creating different sharp?
Yeah, I mean, are you throwing them in the Unreal Engine or are you throwing everything in the camera?
I can do it both ways, and that's one of the exciting things about the tech. If I've got a shot where I need F4 or T4 in the foreground because I've got a focus split on two artists, and then my background's looking too sharp because I'm having to shoot at 4, I can then lie to Unreal Engine. I'll tell it I've got a 49mm signature prime on or whatever lens I've got on, and I'll say, but I'm shooting at 1.8, and that background will go to 1.8. Now, obviously, it's not an optical blur, so the bokeh is different, but what I am able to do, which is pretty unique after all these years, is to be playing on two focal planes as far as depth of field. I want the background to fall off, so my working stops generally. I'm working around between 2.5 and 2.8 most of the time.
And you were on 2.8 on this show?
Yeah, I worked on 2.8 the whole time. That's just a stop that I like without being too mushy in the background, and I never had a problem, or I actually never really thought it could be more out of focus. I didn't even know that there's an option doing this, like, so maybe I would do it the next time, but there was never the need for it.
So you chose the stop from what you like and not necessity on the stage. Okay. Perhaps one more question. Okay, that's so difficult here in the middle. We'll soon get thrown out, so we'll have to.
I have one question about slow motion. So, could you make something like 100 frames per second, or is it not possible?
Did you do any slow motion?
We did 48, but that worked fairly well. Without shutter change or anything, but we couldn't go any further than this.
It's really, but 40,
48 worked, yeah.
That's a limitation of processing power as well. You know,
it's processing power, and Schenk, I mean, if you remember the initial technicalities of this thing, right now we're locked to standard frame rates in this whole studios. It might change, but at the present technology, you have to go on 24, 25, 30, 48, 50, perhaps 60. Because only then you can have standard sync equipment. And that will change, but right now it's a limitation, so you can't go off.
Obviously your content can be at whatever frame rate that you want. I mean, we played in there where we've had high speed content running on the back wall, but your foreground content is running at a different frame rate. Yeah. And then that's just another creative thing to play with.
The actor has to run in 120 frames.
Whatever. Okay.
And the next question is, how movable are these walls? So. It will be have an opportunity to get outside with one wall to make some special shots in the forest or something.
How movable are the walls? I mean, generally not. I mean, they're movable in London. They are movable within their comfort zone, like inside the studio. I would imagine that outdoors it's obviously a light issue. Be a rendering power issue. There's huge render farms that you have to carry around with you, and then it might be better just to do a green screen in this case. It just might be much less expensive.
They're very bright. I mean, the what you've got to remember is that the 5mm screens are designed for rock concerts and they're designed for daytime music festivals. So they're pushing out 5,000 nit. They're almost too bright for the application we want to use them for. And then they've got shaders in them as well, which effectively mean that you can't really go off axis with them. But no, we don't have an issue with exposure. We've got an issue. We're NDing to within an inch of our lives most of the time.
Yeah. Well, I fear we have to shut this down soon.
Nobody is killing us, but if there are no more questions, then I think we wrap it.
Oh, okay, one more, and then yes.
Hello. Yeah. Just about your choice of lenses, maybe your camera setups, just a classic approach, and maybe some anecdotes with other departments. What is new in the style of filming with these walls?
Perhaps on lenses, that would be your department here.
So, the lenses. Yeah, I worked together with ARRI on some lenses. It's also came out just recently. It's called the Alpha. It's based on another lens, and we kind of like worked on it and put some other glass in it and made it possible to work actually on a large format camera. Pretty nice. I really love these lenses. So yeah, it was anamorphic. Again, it was kind of like Mandalorian used anamorphic lenses. So this was also kind of like a given for us, what is a good thing. Sometimes you have to argue for anamorphics. In this case, we hadn't, because we just wanted to, don't have a problem with Moray or whatever, which we never had. So yeah, this was the one thing. And what was the other question? Sorry.
Anecdotes of like typical normal working as we know it compared like for the focus puller or the gaffer or something you will tell, you're telling your friends and fellows, as like, what is new and what comes up every time and it's so crazy. I don't know, something that we understand.
Yeah, I've been 117 days in the volume. I don't have any friends anymore. the working in the volume is just basically the same as it is outside. So one big thing, I don't know if we have the time for it, but one big thing that we put into this volume, and I guess a lot of decisions that we made were just based on, we just didn't know. Nobody did know anything. There were a lot of, you can't do this, but we did some things because we didn't know any better. So one thing was turnaround. So you have a scene in one direction, that's all good with the volume, but what are you doing when you have the reverse shot? You know, is it only just like to left and right, or what are you doing? So then in Mandalorian, I know that they just moved overnight everything from the left side to the right side. They just flipped the whole set in it. With us was, and the director had, he's shooting a lot and he wants to have a lot of setups. He wants to still keep this freedom. So one came up, what about we put it on a turntable in one of these Zoom calls? And everybody was laughing, turntable, that would be great. And then we wanted to go on with talking about it until somebody said, well, what about a turntable? What if we put a turntable in? And we ended up with a turntable, 21 meters, just turntable. So we could drive in or wheel in a set or build a set on it. And it's just like, when we're going to the reverse road, we just flip the whole set around. Of course, you have then to change light from left to right, but you actually can fairly quickly, when you're outside, you also move all the iron from left to right and all the stands and everything. So you can quickly do a turnaround. So this is a thing. Maybe it's an anecdote. I don't know. Another thing, and this is, and maybe then we end it, but I'm kind of excited about it, so I just mentioned it. We had a rain rig in the volume. And now, I don't know if you can see it here. Up there, there's just some piping, the shiny things. So this is actually a rain rig, where everybody said, like, a rain rig in a volume? I mean, this is electricity and rain that doesn't go very well together. but there was just one person who said, I just want a rain rig.
At the end of the production.
And this was the one who actually had a little bit access to the money of it. So at the end, we ended up with a rain rig. And it was all good because we had a fantastic SFX team who built this in there. We never had any problems with one of the screens got water damped or whatever. The set wasn't water damped. And we just had proper rain in it. So that's, I think, is pretty exciting. And a good anecdote.
Thank you very, very much. Thank thank you very, very much, Stephan, Rob, Nick. Thank you very much for the insights. I think we've heard a lot. Don't be afraid. It's an incredible creative tool. It's perhaps not for every shot. It's not the new holodeck, but it gives you a freedom and control, as you mentioned. It definitely try it out. And if you don't have a place to try it out, Stephan will get you in. Sorted, I think. Don't worry, if not, ARRI Rental will do that.
It's an insider.
I know, we're good friends. And the other thing is, it's always good to play with it. But I think when it comes to a real project, that's when you got to deliver, and then when it comes together, I think that's the key. Don't be afraid to take projects. You will manage, and we'll help you with that. Thank you very much to you guys. Thank you very much for you. Please pass us by. We have the 1899 lenses here. Check them out on the booth. And if you want to chat, we're still hanging around. Not in here. We get thrown out, but out there. Thank you very much.